Good morning. Is that better? Thank you. Sorry for the technical hitch there. So good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is as a result of a change of membership. And again, we thank Jenny Minto for her service to the committee and wish her well in her new responsibilities. And this morning we welcome Ben McPherson, MSP, who joins. And can I invite Mr McPherson to make a declaration of interest.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, colleagues and guests. I'm very pleased to be part of the committee as a proud internationalist and the son of a designer, so hope to contribute positively. I refer members to my declaration of interests, and in particular that I'm still registered on the roll of Scottish solicitors, which may be of interest in some of the sessions undertaken. And of course, I also served as Minister for Europe, Migration and International Development, which was underneath the Cabinet Secretary for Culture between May 2018 and February 2020, in case that's of relevance too.
Thank you very much. Our second agenda item is a decision on taking business in private. Are members content to consideration of evidence in private of this meeting at future meetings?
Yes.
Thank you. I hope that made sense. It didn't seem to be. Sorry about that. So our third agenda item is culture and the communities. It's to begin to take evidence on culture and communities inquiry, which is focused on taking place-based approach to culture. And our first session is a round table with local authorities and cultural trusts. And we're joined this morning by Kirsty Cumming, Chief Executive of Community Leisure UK, Heather Stewart, Chief Executive on Fife, Billy Garrett, Director of Culture, Tourism and Events, Glasgow Life, Katie Nicol, Culture Regeneration Lead Officer for Renfrewshire Council, Rebecca Coggins, Principal Officer, Arts and Museums, Dumfries and Galloway Council, and we're joined remotely by Kim Slater from Sport and Culture Services Manager at Moray Council. Heather Stewart is slightly delayed and hopes to join us, as does our committee colleague, Dr. Allen, who may join us in the next little while. So thank you for coming along this morning. And we have three areas of interest to the committee, three themes. I'm going to broadly try to stick to those themes. I know in a round table that can be quite difficult and it can be quite free-flowing. But initially we'll do local and national government issues. Second theme is unmet cultural need, and the third one is place-based cultural policy. And if I could begin by asking, to what extent the Scottish Government's culture strategy influences cultural policy at a local level? I'll maybe just go around the room initially first time. I wondered if, Katie, you wanted to come in first on that.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for the invitation. In terms of the strategies, we obviously in Renfrewshire Council have been working really closely with cultural strategies, as it's influenced so much about our direction of travel, which we have coalesced around the UK City of Culture bid. And what we've done now is we've got a mechanism around partnership approach to cultural regeneration that's influencing our strategy going forward, because what we're trying to do is really embed culture across all of our services through partnership working, and that is across departments, housing, education, criminal justice, health and social care, but also with all our stakeholders and communities. So all of that is influencing our strategy, because what we're trying to do is embed culture into our services, so it's really not sitting as an additional or an add-on, that it's actually part of everything that we're doing. The cultural conversation is taking place right across the whole of our council at the moment. So I would say, yes, the strategy is there as our foundation stone, and we're trying to enhance what we're doing through the council.
Yes, let's say thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to be part of this. It's my first committee, so hope you'll bear with me. But certainly within Dumfries and Galloway Council and Dumfries and Galloway broader, we were very interested to see the National Cultural Strategy. It came with good timing, because our own cultural strategy had come to an end. I guess there's a few points to make. One, we very much appreciated the consultation that went into producing the National Cultural Strategy. So that's what we did when taking forward our own one. We asked in similar ways, how can we support the cultural sector in our area to impact on other areas outside culture? So specifically health and well-being, education, the economy, communities. And we asked our cultural sector, you know, are these the right things that we should be trying to do? And if so, what's stopping us from doing more? So that was the whole really of 2019, 2020, come lockdown, we had to stop for a while. Then we kind of did another piece of work, which was looking at the impact of COVID and what the effect of that had been. And then we produced our own cultural strategy, which has three sort of main areas, which is our people. So that includes the cultural sector itself, but also the people that we're engaging with. Our places, very much the kind of what, because one of the things that are very perhaps timely to this is that one of our first things that we thought about was Dumfries and Galloway as a kind of place, its own sense of place, because a lot of people looking in think of Dumfries and Galloway as a one place, but of course it is Dumfriesshire, it's Galloway, and the feedback very much was, no, wait a minute, it's not one homogenised, you know, area. Each community is different, each community has its own culture, if you like, we have our own, so it's very much kind of the idea is that we need to support that happening in places. And then the third sort of area is, how can we make a difference? So what does it actually take to make a difference in terms of health and well-being for our communities, in terms of community development, in terms of education? And so we're at the stage now of saying, OK, very much, we've got this strategy, that's great. It's not just the council strategy, it's the whole region's strategy, but how do we make things happen? So we're in the process now of trying to establish a cultural partnership which will find a way to kind of a framework to support that to happen. It's in early doors. We're just in the process of doing that at the moment, but sessions like this will be very useful to feed into that. So I hope that's helpful.
Thank you. Could I invite Kim to comment from online?
Thank you, Chair. I would say that the strategy has not necessarily influenced anything as yet from a local level. The Sport and Culture Service for Moray is a relatively new service, and therefore we're taking that very bottom-up approach, looking to sort of gather the data, baseline data of all our cultural activities and opportunities at a local level to help identify the gaps, and therefore then sort of construct where we need to go as a plan moving forward. And hopefully from that bottom-up, top-down approach, we will get, you know, identify the synergies and look, again, similar to one of the previous speakers are saying, ensuring we're embedding that culture into all our services and very much through that partnership working approach. Certainly in Moray, a large percentage of cultural activities are sort of managed, operated and created by our voluntary sector. So it's largely important that as a council we are engaging with those sectors, and as I say, in due course we'll hope the strategy will influence what we are aiming to achieve in the Moray area. Thank you.
Thank you. Kirsty?
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning. I think probably quite a lot of my thoughts reflect the previous speakers in terms of the strategy. From our members' perspective, it's provided a framework which has been really useful, I guess, a framework around the discussion, and also, as was mentioned, the consultation process around the development of the strategy, I think, was really welcomed. I think it opened up discussions around culture, around the importance of culture, around the value of culture, and that's very much where the focus of our members' kind of feedback is, that there needs to be more focus around the value of culture, particularly now. And the cultural strategy gives a bit of a springboard to enable that conversation to happen. It gives a sense of legitimacy to the conversation at a local authority level. So where there are decisions that are being made around services, delivery of services, actually having that strategy in place gives a sense of empowerment to the conversation around culture and the importance of it. In terms of how it's influenced the delivery at a local level, I think it's perhaps a little bit mixed across the country, and that depends very much on local authorities' priorities and how they implement it and how they embed it. But I think another key strand, and I think it was Katie you mentioned this, was about embedding culture across services, across portfolio areas, and taking it out of this kind of silo that it's perhaps traditionally been in. And it still feels there's a bit of work there to do, but again, having the strategy enables the conversation to take place, and that's certainly very much the intention, is actually trying to look at the contribution across policy areas from a cultural perspective for members.
Thank you. And Billy, if you could come in. Thanks.
Thank you, and again, I'll echo everyone else's words. Thanks very much for the invitation today. The question you asked was, to what extent is the national strategy influencing local strategies? And I think my immediate answer to that would be that, speaking from a Glasgow point of view, it is influencing how we are approaching how we conceive, deliver, conceptualise culture within Glasgow. It is influencing that significantly, and in a sense, quite rightly, because I would argue that without a strategic framework, it is very difficult to create a direction of travel, to create a platform and a framework within which you make decisions and create priorities and assess and create the platform decision-making across culture. So the national picture, the national strategy is really important, I think, and it's also the platform within which the conversations with national agencies take place. So from our point of view, that ecosystem is incredibly important. I thought it was interesting what Kim said, and I would agree that, however, it has to be a top-down and a bottom-up approach. So that influence is part of a wider process. So the national strategy, for instance, is influencing in Glasgow right now how we are refreshing and creating a new cultural strategy for the city as part of a process that involves widespread consultation with the sector in the city. So it's part of that overall context, but it's an essential part. So I would argue that and encourage a continued focus on that national cultural strategy. And again, to echo Kirsty's words, because it does reinforce the significance of culture, in terms of both at a community level, at a metropolitan level, at a national level, across a whole range of agendas, from social impact to economic impact to soft power, etc. So I would argue that an investment in the national strategy is incredibly important at a national level.
Okay, thank you very much. And we do want it to be as free-flowing as possible. So if you want to come in on a question or come back with further comment, please indicate to myself and the clerks. We'll try to include everyone as much as possible in the discussion. And on that, I'm going to move to questions from committee members. And if I could introduce Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's really good hearing the opening comments from the witnesses today and also to see the submissions we've had so far. I'd like to kick off with how do we actually see the action taking place, the work between national and local government, between the voluntary and third sector organisations. Funding isn't our job, but local authorities have seen a 29% cut over the last decade. So it's a challenging environment. So how do you make the most of your resources at the local level? How do you work together? And I was thinking of three things to think about: the leadership issue, what are the access to venues, how do you support each other in that, and then employment. And I thought I'd mention those because when we did our work last year, the issue of leadership is important, but access to venues, investment in venues, you know, rocketing prices, and then people leaving the cultural sector. So how do local authorities work together with different cultural organisations to maximise the impact if we've now got this new strategy to make it happen, to let communities access that support? So in terms of who would go first, is anyone volunteering to go first?
I'd be happy to go first.
Do you want to get a kick off?
Unfortunately, on my bag, I don't have a pen to write down all your points there. thank you very much.
And employment, you know, just the practicalities to enable access in our communities.
I think in terms of leadership, where Renfrewshire Council are sitting is that we're, in terms of how we're our governance around Future Paisley, which sits within Renfrewshire Council. It's the Cultural Regeneration Partnership Programme that sits with the investment from Renfrewshire Council. And we have a partnership board that picks up on all our council members. It has representation. It has representation from external stakeholders. It has community involvement right across the piece. And that really drives our conversation around how are we engaging culture that really is about embedding, that isn't just a touch point. It's actually getting into the mix of it. And one of the key things, and the example I'd bring up, is that we've really worked hard with our culture, arts, health and social care partnership. And with that, we've placed a cultural coordinator into the health and social care partnership, which is quite an unusual model because usually it sits within an arts team externally. By placing it right in the heart of it, we are now seeing, for quite modest sums of money, now that that role is in there, that actually we're reaching organisations, communities that we haven't been able to touch before, and it's working with our third sector organisations. And so we're able to start to look at a community wellbeing network that's working alongside another partner, Engage Renfrewshire, which is a third sector interface. We're working with the Alice database to start looking at cultural provision through that database so that professionals and persons, individuals can find resources, services, activities within their local area that they can support. And it's where we can see cultural offer as part of an alternative offer for client base in terms of social work and things like that. We've put money into building capacity funding, making arts and culture accessible and a creative wellbeing fund. That has quite a maximum amount of 2,000 for one of the funds, a maximum of 1,000, but we're seeing really incredible projects coming through that. And then there's also a sort of education between, a sort of a transfer of knowledge between professionals in the third sector and artists-led organisations to understand what the offer is. So it's a really rich seam of activity that's happening. And one of our hopes is, as part of Future Paisley, in terms of influencing, as Billy said, it's about the influential aspect, is that we can look to enhance policy around aspects of this. That's what our long-term goal is, that we can start to change policy across the council. So that is an example, is where we are really seeing proper investment, which we have put in. It's just over 200,000 into that project, and that idea is that we want to work hard to make sure that that will be mainstreamed once Future Paisley investment finishes in April 2024. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm happy to go next.
Sorry. Billy, if you want to go next, if you put your hands up if you want to come in, okay. And I'll come to it, but please you go ahead.
Just thinking about the question, really, and actually listening to Katie, I suppose I could probably combine all of that leadership, venues, employment, that wider question in with two words, really. One is partnerships, and the other is well-being, because I would think that the way that we are approaching the landscape, the really challenging landscape that exists across the public sector nationally, is about that kind of innovative agenda around partnerships and well-being, and what Katie has outlined is exactly that. So the way in which you can still be ambitious, the way in which you can still meet the aspirations of communities and individuals and citizens is by really enhancing and amplifying and accelerating partnerships, and that's partnerships across that health space, that's partnerships across the regeneration space. That's a whole range of innovative and imaginative partnerships. And focusing on that, I suppose, that culture has an intrinsic value, but culture, as we now know, and there's a significant body of evidence, it's that instrumentalism agenda. So culture as an instrument is incredibly powerful in terms of the impact it has on the physical and mental well-being of people who engage in cultural activity. Incredibly strong body of evidence now. So utilising that and taking that evidence to partners allows us to access resources, assets, funding that historically maybe the cultural wasn't accessed for cultural activity. And certainly that's the way that we're approaching it in Glasgow, and our submission included some examples of that. So a very similar kind of approach in Glasgow, the pilot that we're currently running in the east end of the city, Live Well Community Referral, based on social prescribing architecture, but much wider than that, moving away from that medicalised view. And that's part of a wider agenda. It's trying to focus resources on prevention rather than treatment. It's trying to create a vision of health which is community-based and socialised as opposed to medicalised. And if that pilot demonstrates in the way that we're very confident that it will, some really positive impact, then we will be coming and talking to a whole range of partners about how we upscale that to really shift the dial in some of the most deprived communities in Scotland. But that initiative is based on a whole series of partnerships with health organisations and regeneration agencies. So immediately we're tapping into that employability agenda as well. And some examples, going back a few years, we worked with Clyde Gateway as part of a population health initiative in the East End, which actually worked with the health board to get people from the east end of Glasgow into jobs in the health board. I mean, literally, you know, specific, tangible employability programmes. So I think it's about partnerships. It's about that wider wellbeing agenda. It's about working with partners in a way that we maybe haven't done in the past to a much greater extent. So I suppose that's how I would articulate that.
Thank you. And Kirsty, do you want to come in?
Thank you. So, I mean, I think, again, I kind of echo Billy's thoughts around partnership wellbeing, but if I was to kind of look at it from a slightly different angle, I guess, and kind of look at some of the challenges that go alongside that, I mean, there's obviously evidence of what happens when there's really good practice and partnership working, which should be celebrated, and Katie, you've kind of highlighted that very well, but equally there's challenges where culture doesn't have the profile at a local level. So we're seeing, you know, with some of the changes across local authorities, there's not necessarily people with a cultural remit within the local authority. That expertise is somewhere lost. So where we have a culture trust, there's not necessarily that connect into the local authority with the expertise to really understand and really embed some of the issues. So there's certainly a change in terms of the kind of local authority expertise and angle on that. Also, if we look at community planning partnerships, again, the voice of culture is not consistent across community planning partnerships across the country. So again, there's opportunities, very much as Billy said, for partnership working, for, you know, real opportunities to come through that. But where there's not the connect to community planning, to health and social care partnerships, or through the local authority, that's where we're seeing significant issues around that value of culture coming through. So the partnership absolutely needs to be there, but there needs to be the right kind of flags in the grounds to connect those different agencies at a local level. Otherwise, it becomes the ownership of one organisation to drive culture, which is where we then see the kind of move back towards silo working, which is not where we want to be. Picking up on your other points around access to venues and employment. Employment, and I think we highlighted this in our submission, continues to be a significant challenge across our members, both in terms of recruiting skilled people into the sector, retaining those people, really seeing it as an attractive opportunity, a career pathway for people to come and actually progress through. So there's a significant challenge there that it's not seen as perhaps an attractive opportunity for people that are looking for which sector to go into, but also in terms of the levels of pay. Again, we highlighted this in our submission, that actually there's a real challenge in being able to compete with some of the other sectors or to compete with private sector in terms of remuneration and making it attractive for people to stay within the sector. And there are specific hotspots within our members where there's really just a real lack of staff and an inability to recruit into those positions, which therefore impacts on the delivery of services. Thank you.
Thank you. Kim, do you want to come on?
Yes, thank you. And it was actually picking up a point that Kirsty just commented on there about the silo working. You know, culture is so diverse in the areas that it includes, and what we have found difficult is bringing those different themes together, because you know the people that are involved have very niche markets or specific areas that they're focusing on, be that music or heritage or, you know, arts, etc. And it's the difficulty to pool all these individuals and organisations together to collectively move the cultural theme forward. So it is trying to, you know, in regards to the leadership, it's these trying to pocket these communities of interest together for that greater gain is something in Moray that we have, I would say, is a challenge. The other point in the question was about around venues. In Moray, we would say, again, there has been a lack of investment in venues, and a lot of our venues, community halls, even council facilities, don't necessarily have got the technology or the setup to provide cultural activities to the extent that organisations are seeking. However, we are working quite significantly with our Learn and Estate colleagues and also with our Open Spaces team in regards to really supporting our, you know, open parks, green spaces, to really promote the cultural activities and programmes that could be operating in Moray. And that's been highly successful since our return from COVID, and we're seeing a greater increase in the use of open spaces for culture, which, considering the Moray climate, can be a challenge, but it is certainly an area of interest for us to develop.
Thank you. Rebecca, do you want to...
I'm just picking up some of the points that colleagues have made there about the kind of profile, I suppose, of culture within councils. I mean, we are one of the few services that directly running cultural facilities, museums and galleries, and a small cinema within the council. But I was just reflecting that 15 years ago, we had an arts manager, we had a museums manager, we had two development officers in the visual arts and crafts sort of side, four curators. There's now myself, arts and museums, two curators, no development officers. I'm the only one within the team that doesn't have a role actually within a venue. But I'm taking forward the cultural strategy, but I'm three tiers down, because I noted in the there was a reference to the culture conveners, and I was just thinking, in our situation, although the council's incredibly positive and incredibly supportive of cultural and creative activity, the community's committee covers governance and assurance, roads and infrastructure, community engagement and neighbourhood services, and I'm in neighbourhood services along with customer services, registration, libraries, financial wellbeing and revenues, the fleet, transports and operation, the buses, community assets, which includes all the many village halls, but a lot of those have been devolved to communities. And then you get to leisure, culture and wellbeing. And we've got 13 museums and galleries. So if you like, it's difficult to make the case up. And to get into community planning, I have to go another tier up and across and down. But I guess, to be honest, it's always been like that. And I think part of our success in Dumfries and Galloway is the fact that we've acknowledged that we're not the only cultural providers. We have to work with the voluntary sector, with the individuals out there. And I think we've always, you know, since I've been there, which is more than 20 years, we've always taken a kind of enabling role. So I guess that's kind of where the leadership perhaps comes from. We were lucky to have, in 2012, when... things were looking particularly difficult, we were lucky in getting one of the first place partnerships with Creative Scotland, and that actually helped us to invest in creating a network within our cultural and creative sector, and that was called initially the Chamber of the Arts. It's now DG Unlimited, and that kind of brings together, it has a membership, a little bit like Kim was saying, that how do you draw together all of those voices, or those, you know, there's some of the bigger arts organisations, bigger museums, independent museums, but there's also the freelance potters, musicians. How do you draw those all together? Well, supporting networks can do that. And I think the cultural strategy now has given us another opportunity to look at how we configure that. We've got the Dumfries and Galloway Chamber for the Arts. We've also got a heritage network, which is growing now. That's through the support of Museums Galleries Scotland. But one of the kind of key things that makes these things happen is capacity. As I think I put in my submission, that what we really need to sort of like to get this all going is to kind of as Billy was saying, working in partnership, but it's building that capacity. At the moment, there was a recent study done, I think, employment, or if you include freelancers in that, the number of people who are employed and active in the sector across Dumfries and Galloway is actually more than there are employed in agriculture. So there's a lot of people out there. But it's very fragile existence. It's very hand-to-mouth. Certainly, thinking about the earlier question about what the cultural strategy has done, the Culture Collective programme supported the Stove Network in Dumfries and Galloway to create the What We Do Now project, and that's taking a creative placemaking approach to regeneration in towns across the region. But a lot of their time is spent fundraising, and I see that from a lot of our cultural organisations. Dumfries, Upland, which took on the role from the council when we lost our development offices of developing the visual arts and crafts businesses through things like the Springfling Open Studios, they're spending a lot of their time just fundraising to make sure that they can continue for the next year. So I guess that's the kind of the employment area. Although I think we do have a lot of really dedicated people there. And the venues, that is a challenge, and in a very rural area, definitely. And I guess from the museum side of things, it's also that the issue of the energy costs to keep things going. I mean, thinking of the museums that we have and our independent partners have, we're the custodians for the heritage of our communities. It's really vital and important work, but to keep those things safe, we need energy to run the buildings, to maintain the environmental conditions. So it is challenging. So
thank you. I'm going to bring Sarah in, and I think Ben's got I'll take both those points and then we can open it to the floor again. So Sarah.
Yeah, I think that's really helpful feedback, because part of it is about how you're coordinating at the local level. And I think your points there about who's doing that coordination and leadership in each local authority area, so that there's somebody who's then making the connections with health and social care partnerships or venues or third sector organisations. It's how you have the architecture. And I think with the strategy is there's sharing of best practice between local authorities in terms of different types of areas, very rural-based areas, city-based areas. How do you get that best practice and then kick it into other council department areas or health and social services to get them to start buying in, not on a health-based approach, but on a wellbeing approach, like you suggested?
Thank you, Convener. Just to elaborate on what's already been said, I wondered if the panel wanted to reflect any feedback or ideas and initiatives in terms of their engagement with Creative Scotland on the implementation of the strategy, and any other feedback or constructive suggestions in terms of how they engage with national government going forward.
Okay. Sam, do you want to come in first?
I didn't quite catch the very end of your question, sorry.
Sorry, Mr. Garrett. I was just wondering if there's anything in terms of implementation of the strategy that you would want to feedback over and above what's in your submissions in terms of your engagement and collaboration with Creative Scotland and national government more widely.
Thanks. In a sense, I might connect that question to the point that Ms. Boyack was making just at the end, because I think, and I do mention that in my submission, I think there are a number of areas where we could do better, and that one of these areas is principally about connections and connecting. So that question that Ms. Boyack asked about to what extent are we sharing best practice across agencies, local authorities, trusts, etc., I think that is an area where we could do better, to be honest. I'm not sure there is really any kind of comprehensive process for us doing that. And I might argue, and this is where I maybe comment on the question that you've asked, and I might argue that, in a sense, one of the areas where the platform, we're starting from a reasonably strong position, but I think one of the things that I think one of the areas where we could do better is that is the connection between, if you like, the national peace, the metropolitan peace, the regional peace, and the connections at a local level. I'm not quite sure that is completely coherent. I think there is probably more that collectively we can do about that. Our relationships, I think, with the national agencies, Creative Scotland's one, Museum Gallery Scotland, are positive. But I think, given the challenges that we face, and some of them have been mentioned and some of them are in our submissions, I think we have to do a little bit better. And recent events that we have seen, I think, display that slight lack of, in a sense, coherence between the local authority, national government level, whether that's at Scottish or UK level, if you think about some of the recent funding decisions that have been taken. So I think there's absolutely no basis for criticism of anyone. I just think we could probably all do a little bit better in terms of ensuring that there is a coherent picture up and down and across the sector. I suppose that's how I would describe it. Not sure if that answers your question, but that's how I would describe it.
It did, and I just perhaps any reflections today or following the committee session, if there's any constructive propositions for how that could be facilitated, that greater coordination, that would be interesting to hear.
Okay, I'm going to bring Kim in and then Rebecca after that again. Thanks.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Just 2 points, really. The first one, yes, we do have an excellent relationship with Creative Scotland, the named national agency there. However, again, I would say the very focus with us is around music. And again, this is where we'll go back to our silo working slightly across the theme of culture. So certainly for Murray, the connection with Creative Scotland is very much music. And then if you take, for example, the SLIC, so the Scottish Library and Information Council, again, very much focused on the sort of libraries, learning, heritage, etc. there. So again, work very well with national organisations, but it's that, again, that overarching culture piece that we may struggle with. And the second point, really, I just wanted to come in, again, back to that connection with likes of health and social care. In Murray, we're progressing very much with social prescribing, and I think culture has certainly got a place in the social prescribing model as we move forward, and again, ensuring all private, public and third sector agencies are connected to that social prescribing model. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll bring Rebecca and then Katie in after that.
I suppose I was thinking, in a way, the kind of national should mirror the regional. I'm just thinking of how things are happening kind of with us very much as we see the partnership, the cultural partnership that we're trying to establish as having a kind of connecting role between the different elements of our sector and with, say, for example, health service. And again, it's that kind of introduction role. It's we certainly see probably one of the first things that the partnership will do in Dumfries and Galloway is, for example, with the health and wellbeing teams. We know that the kind of there's an understanding of the benefits that culture can have, very much as we were saying, the preventative agenda with the cultural sort of sector. You've got people who are keen and willing to kind of engage in that, but they don't have the connect. Neither of them know about each other. They don't know what the potential is. The cultural sector knows that it has value, but it doesn't know how to translate that into a health setting, clinical or community. And likewise, the clinical and community health services don't really know what the potential is. And so I guess there is that kind of learning from each other and those connections making and those partnerships happening kind of within the region. But I can see at a national level that also needs to happen. And I found Creative Scotland and Museums Gallery Scotland to have a similar kind of connecting role. And I think back to the place partnerships. Creative Scotland, certainly before lockdown, were every now and again arranging for all the place partnerships to come together and to learn from each other. And I remember going to Aberdeen with some of the creative and cultural organisations from Dumfries and Galloway, just as we were starting to think about the cultural strategy. And it was hugely valuable to hear from the other place partnerships how they were doing that. And a lot of that learning then translated down into what we're doing in Dumfries and Galloway. But it is true that the danger is that we get too focused on our own little situation and we don't see what's happening elsewhere. We have another opportunity, I suppose, across the south of Scotland in that we have the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency and the South of Scotland Regional Economic Strategy, which does also have culture and creativity as a focus. So that has started us to think more about Scottish Borders Council, but they do, and Live Borders, but they do things very differently. But often it's just the time to get your head up and actually look around. So that's one of the reasons why it's so good to be here today, to hear from everybody else. But I think those opportunities would be very welcome if they could resume.
Katie?
Yes, thank you. It was just really picking up on the relationship again with Creative Scotland and picking up on Rebecca's point about place partnership. It just feels like actually there is so much good content that comes there because it is embedded in communities. We're obviously, in Renfrewshire Council, we're just in the midst of a place partnership agreement with Creative Scotland, which is a 400 grand, 1,000 investment, 200 from Future Paisley and 200 from Creative Scotland, and we're delivering on 5 place partnership programmes. They're all at slightly different levels, but one of them is in, you know, working in partnership with, like, for instance, in Johnston, it's to create a Johnston textile space, and it's working with Business Consortium, Historical Society, Makers, Remotor about ethical and sustainable clothing. So it's this where you can coalesce around an idea and you really embed it in as a public-facing, community-led partnership. And so this one really has so much opportunity for us to build on because we're building something in Paisley around a film and media space, again, rather an inspired space that sits on the campus of University of West of Scotland, but it's front-facing onto Story Street. So it will be a place where we can talk about archiving footage, we can talk about new digital media. It's all of these things that are coming from the grassroots level up, but it's consolidated by business. And then we're developing a Cycle Arts Festival, which is going to be in its third iteration this year. We've received money from Events Scotland to support the UCI Cycling Fringe programme, which is really exciting because that will happen just in advance of the main event. And so there is all of this learning, but I agree with Billy. I think in some ways, local authorities being able to share best practice, and I think for Renfrewshire Council, we believe some of the models that have come out from that whole ambition of the UK City of Culture bid, we're pushing some really innovative thinking. Cultural coordinators are sitting within health and social care. We're doing an incredible partnership at Castlehead High School with secondary school that's linked to Glasgow School of Art. But that is progressing a whole new way of qualifications that sits outside the SQA framework around creative thinking and saying to young people there are possibilities to find work within the culture and creative sector and don't discount it and don't discount it from primary school as you go into secondary school choices that actually, you know, within the creative and culture sector there is still the need for marketing, technology, accountancy, all of these things still exist together. But we are building a really strong base in which to offer up possibilities for employability. And one of our main step changes is about where do that younger generation, how do we build our new creative workforce and what are the stepping stones? So we're working actively across our council, our youth services, our developing young workforce, our careers, and then we're working with University of West of Scotland and West College Scotland. We're working with Skills Development Scotland. All of these people are represented on our partnership board. And so therefore, we want to get a much clearer linear line that we can show how best to progress and bring it together. Because instead of, as we all have been talking about, these disparate strands and what we're trying to do at Renfrewshire is bring it into one comprehensive offer.
Thank you. Kirsty, thanks.
Thank you. Just, I guess, kind of picking up on the partnership piece particularly, I think what we've seen is one of the very few positives that came out of the pandemic was the increase in partnership working. So we saw, you know, during COVID, you know, when we're in lockdown, a number of agencies came together that previously hadn't, you know, sat together virtually, albeit, you know, in the same meeting, to actually understand how to respond to the pandemic from a cultural perspective. And that was really important. And we've been working really hard to maintain that partnership. So that's across. So we facilitate a group, we call it the Culture Partners Group, which comprises Creative Scotland, Scottish Government, SLIC, Museums, Galleries, COSLA, Regional Screen Scotland, Screen Scotland, a whole range of different partners that sit on that group. And it's a monthly meeting, but certainly the feedback that we had and from ourselves as well was that actually that connection was really, really important. It wasn't there before COVID. We just hadn't really engaged as a collective. And it comes back to, I think it was Kim's point around the kind of engagement with national agencies and a kind of silo function. It's actually how do we start to join up a little bit more and under the kind of broad cultural umbrella, you know, how do we actually work together as museums, as theatres, as libraries to actually talk about the value of culture through that partnership. So I think there's opportunities to do more to continue with that partnership working. I know that there's also some discussion around a network for local authority and culture trust arts officers that's being led by Creative Lives at the moment, who are looking again at that kind of void that's there. So I know that they're exploring something to kind of pull together a bit of a network of learning and sharing. We've had some discussions with COSLA around the culture conveners. You know, how does that work? You know, what's the actual purpose of it? And maybe just, you know, shaping that a little bit more so that there's more value and a clearer purpose that sits around that. But I think overall there's certainly, as Billy said, there's areas that could be improved. I think the national local dynamic needs a bit more coordination, but I think as well as that there's certainly been progress, significant progress that's perhaps come out of the pandemic.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to everyone. I've got two areas to explore. The first is around what might be termed barriers to culture. We've had a lot of individual responses to the committee's inquiry, and I think the issues that arise won't come as a surprise to many of you, but they are things like lack of public transport, especially in rural areas, a lack of options for young people, young families. One issue that resonated with me was a person from the Highlands who said that there were more events during the tourism season and not so many in quieter times of year. Access for disabled people, price and availability of venues. As I say, all issues I don't think will come as a surprise, but I just wondered if I could have the panel's observations on all or some or any of those. And I don't know who wants to look here. Rebecca, I don't know if you want to go first.
Well, I mean, yes, I mean, certainly very familiar with the idea, with the lack of public transport. I mean, Dumfries and Galloway's, it's 100 miles across. It's 6,000 square kilometres and 150,000 people, so very sparsely populated. And it is an issue, definitely, of kind of like how to program, how to support things happening. We have, for example, Dumfries and Galloway Arts Festival, which puts on events across the whole of the region and has been supporting, funded by Creative Scotland and our small sort of resources, a program called Arts Live, which is supporting kind of promoters, community-based promoters to put on events in their own communities. But there is that whole issue of how do you make that sustainable? How do you make things... That cost thing, it costs to put things like that on. It's also this whole question of climate and the whole kind of business of bringing something in and what kind of that costs environmentally. And then it's like, how can people access that if you were to charge the cost that it would actually recover what it took to put on? That's not affordable for your small community to access. So I think that's definitely the case. And we hear the sort of same thing about... young people, and I suppose there are quite a few things on in the sort of tourism season. But having said that, events that we put on in the or that we see being put on shoulder season do kind of get quite a lot of local activity. But it goes back to that kind of demographic. How do you serve those people that you have and the visitors who are coming in across such a wide and sparsely populated area and make that possible to do? There are, you know, we've been interviewing for an access officer for one of our museum's teams, and I won't say any names, but a bright young person we were interviewing said along the lines of, you know, looking at your photographs on your websites, they're mainly older people or families. Where's the activity for young people? Where's the kind of activity for the kind of like the working people who maybe don't want to go into a facility and be overrun by small children? You know, what about, have you thought about changing your opening hours? Are you sure that what you're providing is what people want, if you like. And I guess that's part of the, what we need to be taking, you know, with our cultural partnership. One of the things I think we need to start to do is to look at that, to sort of see if there's any way that we can support our cultural sector to sort of rethink maybe the model of what we're doing at the moment. Maybe it needs to be tweaked. It has to be more responsive. I mean, that's basically what we're saying. And to overcome those barriers, you need to be responsive. You need to listen to those people. What are the barriers and how can you overcome them? And I guess it's about kind of with that leadership question, it's how you can push that down the line, if you like, so that I think it shouldn't be top down. We're sort of making sure that people have access to what we decide they want, they should have. But how do we support our communities, that people to actually get involved in and growing the things that they want? Does that make sense?
Kitty? Thank you. And thanks for the question, because I think the barrier, there's quite a lot of options around that question, but how we're trying to break down barriers really in organisations. I was just thinking about the Promise. We know we're doing a lot of work with the Promise, with care experienced young people and children and young carers, and a lot of the work that we're doing that is breaking down barriers, because it could be because of economic climate, it could be attitude, it could be logistics, all of those things. And it's trying to find a way to go to them. So we're doing quite a lot of work with four of our care homes in Renfrewshire, but we're also doing a huge arts and cultural programme to try and say, what is it you want? It's a really youth-led approach, and it's all about co-production, co-design. It's not like, we're going to tell you to come and do this. So it's really been an extraordinary exercise to see the growth in that, and we're sort of building a Promise Champions, and we're trying to introduce them to a lot of different opportunities to say, actually, if we're talking about the impact of inequalities, we're trying to find a level playing field. And those barriers about what it is, even using the word culture, it's better to use creativity for somewhere like a group like the Promise, for instance. But I think it's that thing, as Rebecca was saying, it's where we can discuss, where we're finding out from our organisations, and we do a lot of work with this incredible foundation of cultural organisations, and they're doing work throughout the year. So we can populate with events and key festivals, Paisley Book Festival, the big Halloween event, but in between there is always offers. That is one thing we certainly have, whether that's in Erskine or Johnston or in Paisley, Kilbarkin, Renfrew. It's there to access, because that is the point that we're trying to get to. So all of those barriers, as we work through our services, finding ways to not have high ticket prices, having opportunities for volunteering at events for young people, just ways in which you can say, this doesn't sit out with your opportunity. It's all accessible for everybody. That is our position we're trying to get to.
I'll bring Billy. I wonder if I could just ask a very quick supplementary just on what both Rebecca and Katie have been talking about, because I think one of the things we're trying to look at is the disparity between urban areas and rural areas and the offering. And when you said that about the book festival, I was interested in finding out from Rebecca, when I think of your area, I think of the Wigton Book Festival, the Stranraer Oyster Festival, the Port Patrick Folk Festival. So are you engaged with those festivals as they happen across the region as well?
Yes, we are. A lot of those organisations are very prominent within our cultural partnership and kind of working in certain, and we are very fortunate in Dumfries and Galloway as well that the council is invested in events and an events strategy. So there's about, I think, 360,000 which is used to support events across the region, and there are, I think it's 6 signature events, of which 4 are cultural. So that includes Dumfries and Galloway Arts Festival, the Spring Fling Open Studios, the Wigton Book Festival, as you were just mentioning, and the Big Band Supper. And all of those, you know, they have a very strong impact in terms of, I guess, that strategy was originally an economic development strategy in a way, and looking to draw people into the area. But those organisations also have a really, really key impact on the communities that they work with. And each of them has a sort of a sort of like a wider developmental role, if you like. That's one of the things that we saw through the establishment of the Chamber of Arts, that feeling that actually the developmental kind of aspect has passed from the council and maybe the arts agency that we used to have to those organisations. So, for example, Wigton Book Festival sees itself, it does the festival, but it also has it sees itself as having a developmental role for literature, for writers, for readers across Dumfries and Galloway, and they work with the Moat Bray Literature Centre in Dumfries, and they have a sort of, if you like, a strategic head-on in terms of developing literature and access to literature. And the same thing would be with the Dumfries and Galloway Arts Festival, that kind of developmental sense in performing arts across the region. Spring Fling Open Studios, very much how do we support individual creative, visual artists and craft makers, businesses, those sole traders, how do we support them to come together? So if you like that, there's very much a kind of, and Big Burn Supper, I should say, is one of the most inclusive festivals that we have, really kind of engaging with the community in and around Dumfries and some of the more poor and deprived areas and getting them involved. So if you like, there's a sort of like a strategic thing that they're doing that I suppose we see is our role is in a supportive framework that helps that to happen.
Thank you. Donald, did you want back in? Yeah. I want to bring Donald in, and then I'll come to Billy.
I actually had a separate point or observation to make, which I'll probably just raise now just for the sake of timing. But one of the things that Creative Scotland said to us was that there are certain cultural practices, in their view, which don't necessarily take place in theatres or music venues, and they raise Gaelic culture and traditional music, and I'm sure we can think of others. And I just wondered if, in addition to the point I made earlier, if the panel had any views on that. And I appreciate it slightly segues into the question of what is cultural need. And I've been very struck by your responses about determining the co-production and determining cultural need through what people are saying sort of organically, as it were. So I don't know if you'd like to address that as well. Sorry, that's quite a lot of...
Finish on that point, because I think as you know, Paisley has these incredible cultural venues, but they're all under refurbishment. So when all of those buildings, the Town Hall, the Arts Centre, the Museum and the new Central Library are coming online, we have invested across the whole of Renfrewshire and to build the cultural ecology. So we are not in venues at the moment. I mean, obviously there are venues, Johnson Town Hall, and you know there are venues, but we are working in a much more fluid way. So there's this rather brilliant old cooperative building that sits in Paisley that's three floors, enormous. It is now the home of Outspoken Arts and Pace Theatre. So it is now a space within a shopping mall where you get absolute access into really high quality cultural experiences. And when we did the Future Paisley exhibition, again, it was in a shopping mall. It was a bespoke offer where people would come in, comment on the ideas, say what their needs are for the community, but it was all addressed within spaces that anybody could occupy. It was this egalitarian space, not to say that theatres and things aren't, but it was because they weren't there, we were able to utilise different ways of approaching people. And again, that's about breaking down barriers to expectations on culture.
Billy.
Thank you. In terms of the barriers, I think it's important that we don't give the impression there's a kind of slick answer to that. I think we live with those challenges, and I think the answer, and I think that's reflected in what people have said, the answer is to ensure that we weave in to our practice on a permanent basis, in a sense, a set of values and a set of principles about how we approach what we do. So those, and these have been mentioned, so co-production I think is key. So rather than us forming a view of what it is that people want and where they want it and how they want to access it, we actually discover that in partnership with citizens and communities. Diversity, that's diversity of programme, diversity of space, diversity of presentation, inclusivity, which is slightly different. So it's about building in, I think, a whole range of values and principles into everything that we do. Locality, working, place-based approaches, person-centred approaches. It's building those values and principles across our sector. When I talk about diversity, so for instance, some of our, in Glasgow, some of our cultural output will be the Royal Scottish National Orchestra in the concert hall. But at exactly the same time, some of our cultural output is people who are signposted to cultural activity through our community referral programme, and it happens in their community. It's completely free, and it's built on 20-minute neighbourhood principles. So in those kind of different ways, we are trying to tackle that issue around ensuring that there is something, in a sense, for everyone, and that our overall content is barrier-free in as far as we can make it. I think that the issue about where cultural activity takes place, I think, is just so important. Because I think we have to be clear, cultural activity can take place absolutely anywhere. It can just take place absolutely anywhere. It can take place in a pub, in a park, at a street corner, and in the tramway or the National Concert Hall. And certainly that's, I think, probably you'll find out that's how absolutely everyone around this table approaches culture. We're very fortunate in Glasgow to stage what is now, I think, the world's largest winter roots music festival, Celtic Connections. And a significant part of that is produced in partnership with Glasgow's significant Gaelic community. When people think about Celtic Connections, they probably think about the concert hall and the really exciting programme that happens there. But actually, Celtic Connections takes place in about 30 to 40 venues all over Glasgow, church halls, pubs, a whole range of facilities, including, for instance, in the most recent iteration, the cruise ship at down in Govan that was housing Ukrainian refugees. We did concerts there that were completely free. So I think that has to be the approach, a multiplicity of approaches, multiplicity of content, multiplicity of kind of venues, content, but with those principles and values woven in throughout. I think that's how, because it's an ongoing, constant process, because barriers change. I think it was Katie mentioned that you can always be surprised about what the barriers are. You know, it's threshold anxiety, you know. So I think it's important that we evolve our practice around those. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. I know, Kim, you dropped out for a little while there. Is there anything you want to add at this point?
I suppose just the note about, I noticed one of the barriers mentioned was transport. And yes, Murray is a rural local authority, and it is certainly something that has been commented on by both residents and tourists in regards to culture activities, the lack of public transport. And again, you know, we don't necessarily see that as a barrier. It's like, how can we improve on that situation and challenge? And again, that's where some of our local communities come in and provide that support mechanism, because the public transport resource is just not there or sufficient enough to cope with the demand. We're about to have the Spirit of Speyside Whisky Festival in Murray in the forthcoming weeks, which is an extensive array of activities in very rural Speyside where there is no public transport. And again, it's where communities come forward willing to identify how we can transport our local residents and tourists to ensure they access those cultural activities. So completely appreciate that transport is a barrier in our local authority, and it's just trying to provide that network of support to ensure that anyone and everyone can access any cultural activity or event that's available to them. Thank you.
Thanks. Kirsty, you hadn't come in on those, so you get anything you want to add?
Just a couple of points, probably just building on Billy's comments, really. I'm not going to dwell on the barriers, but in terms of addressing the barriers, and we touched on this earlier, there's certainly something around the partnership working and across different agencies. So understanding where the barriers are, but also who's best placed to engage with to actually access those communities, to understand needs better and to make it much more of a partnership approach. I think the other two points that I wanted to kind of touch on, one is the role of volunteering as well. So, you know, how does volunteering actually help in terms of breaking down some of those barriers? You know, the opportunity to engage people through volunteering, to bring different people into services, and also to use volunteers as a way to engage with different communities that's perhaps seen as less formalised in terms of engagement, rather than it being an organisation that's reaching out and approaching the public. There's a role for volunteers there, and how do we maximise that, and how do we maximise the skill set that we have within our volunteers? And the third point I wanted to touch on was really just in terms of understanding where the barriers are and in terms of understanding who's participating. I think there's still a piece of work to do in terms of the data and actually understanding who's using, you know, what services are they using, how are they using them. I think there's a lot of anecdotal data across the sector, but certainly across our members, I think they would struggle to give a very concrete picture of exactly what it looks like across different services. So there's a bit of work perhaps to do just to understand, you know, from an inclusivity perspective, there certainly seems to be a lack of really concrete data that we can actually build on, so we can actually see and monitor progress in a way that's more than kind of anecdotal or bit pieces across different services.
Thank you. We've certainly moved into the second area of unmet cultural need. And I just wondered, I think it was Katie, you mentioned that you had been able to reach some of the really hard to reach areas with the partnership and the work. Are you possible to say a little bit more about how that works?
Thank you. I think it's that thing about because we're embedding that cultural possibility across all of our services, that we're able, I mean, the promise is obviously a national, it sits within a national policy context, but to really start to see what's happening when we put in a promise, an arts engagement programme, that actually now we have individual social workers going to the promise group to say, can you come and speak to us? Where can we do more with this group of young people and young carers? And that breaking down of the barrier and accessing groups that you may not normally get to has been a really, really insightful aspect. I think across our full programme, it's a way, we were talking about co-production, because co-production is absolutely everybody's USP, it feels, because that is our way in. But somewhere like the Paisley Museum, they have been working with Syrian refugees, looking at the collection, the Syrian glass in the collection. This is English as a second language, so we're doing an Arabic and English translation, so that then that goes into the museum. There's a ownership, there starts to be an ownership on groups that we're not meeting immediately, so we're finding ways in. There's this amazing other programme that's coming through the co-production with the YMCA and Paisley, and they're working, they have a whole sort of digital program there, and there's a group of girls who are interested in STEM subjects, and so they found this old loom in the Paisley Museum collection, this jacquard weaving loom, and it has a binary formation, which then is the same that's used in computer programming. So now there's going to be this whole new level of work, which we would not have met those young people, and that's been a long time. That is a conversation that started 2018. So these are building trust, building relationships, getting in there. The whole thing, what we're trying not to do is just come in and come out. What we're trying to do is get in under the skin. And where we have our big event portfolio, we've also got projects with the Criminal Justice Programme, where we're working with women who are on criminal community payback orders. They're learning a skill on how to make, like, embroidery, making stuff, that then they can either donate or they put into a way of selling the product to put the money back into the programme. So this idea that they go off with a skill set, it's this idea that you have another step to take. And I think reaching groups like these, this is what this cultural programme is being able to do, is to get into areas that would not normally have been seen. Mm-hmm. But certainly through our young people, that is our big, big development work as well.
My own local YMCA has recently been engaging, and we have a thing called Future Fridays in North Lanarkshire, where the schools finish early and then there's activities put on. But they've actually set up an esports club, and it's a proper kind of league, but it has brought in young people who are isolated from other activities into being part of that community. And so quite an interesting example too.
Inclusion thing, because Erskine Arts work a lot with young people who are choosing not to be in school, you know, like they really don't see education, another step in education. And so they're coming to Erskine Arts, they're learning how to put a backline in for a stage, they're learning how to use equipment, filming, editing, and it's and they're called the crew. And it's an amazing opportunity because it doesn't, you're not always fed through one route. You can find different ways through.
Thank you. Mark, Billy, did you want to come in there just now and comment on?
Just in terms of the question that you'd asked, it feels to me there's maybe two parts to that question. And I suspect we would all say the same thing. One part of that, in terms of, whatever it is that we do, what does success look like, and how do we know when we've got there? And the answer to that is evidence, is data, is evaluation. So we are all engaged in various evaluation, evidence gathering, data surveys, etc., processes, and I'm sure that that runs throughout all of our submissions. One thing I would say, however, and I feel this quite strongly, is that there are the numbers, you know, there is the empirical data, but what is just so powerful and so important is people's stories and just the testimony that people who are engaged in those programmes give you. And one thing that I might say is that quite often, whether it's funders, whether it's partners, there's a real emphasis on the hard data, on the numbers, on the crunching. And that's legitimate and that's understandable. But we shouldn't ignore the stories of people who are engaged in those programmes and how it's made them feel and what impact it's had on them and their words and their feelings. I think that's really important. But that's one part, I think. So I think we're all engaged in that process. But the other part, I think, of your question is, how actually do we go about getting to those who are currently furthest from engagement, furthest from participation? I think that's one of the areas where I think there's a bit of a positive picture. I think collectively the sector is becoming really quite good at that. I think you've probably heard, and in the submissions there's a number of examples of programmes and projects which are actually doing that. You know, I've given you an example of, for instance, our community referral programme, based currently in terms of our pilot, based in Carlton, within one of the most challenging communities in Glasgow, in fact, probably in Scotland, and how we are engaging and how we're working with other agencies to identify communities, identify individuals, identify families, working with education, working with social work. So I think that is another area where we are becoming really quite good at opening ourselves up, at working with other agencies and partners to absolutely do that as part of our wider commitment to the sector. I think one of the challenges around that, however, to go back to challenges, is that it is, and I think it was Rebecca that said this earlier, it is a little bit fragile, it is a little bit precarious, just because of the financial landscape. It's all a little bit project by project. And and it's maybe part of the question that you asked, Mr. McPherson. And this is very difficult, and it's the kind of thing that people like myself always ask for. If there was a way of constructing a much longer-term strategic funding framework around some of this incredibly impactful and positive work, that would make a real difference. That would make a really big difference. In terms of shifting the dial nationally, that would make a real difference. So, thank you.
I'm sure you'll be aware that our budget inquiry, one of the recommendations from that was about multi-year funding and more sustainable funding for the arts, so something we have covered already. Does anyone else want to come in on the unmet need, kind of the gaps area? Rebecca?
Yes, it was just to kind of emphasise again, just as Billy was saying, I guess there's that, I suppose it would be really good to be able to kind of move beyond that area where we need to keep gathering all the evidence and spending such a lot of capacity and time on doing that to make the case. And I think that the long-term view is really important. I'm just sort of thinking of it. There are so many different examples of where those making those connections and building that, you know, getting those communities involved is so important. But I think back to, I think it's the Kukubri Galleries, there was a kind of health and wellbeing project that ran for a summer, I think it was, but then it stopped because the funding stopped. But the people who were involved didn't stop coming into the gallery and looking for you know, where's the creative writing group? Can you help me? Going to the, you know, up to the staff, can, you know, wanting that connection, because they'd built that community, that kind of experience through those sessions, and then suddenly they were removed, and it's almost like worse. You know, so it does need to be long term, but I think there's such evidence of the positive impact it can have.
Thanks, Kitty.
Sorry, just to finish off that unmet needs piece, I think that thing that Billy and everybody has been talking about around social prescribing being a really essential part of it. We have invested in a role for a cultural social prescribing role within One Wren, who is obviously the arm's length charity that sits to deliver services on behalf of Renfrewshire Council. And that role is really instrumental within our CASC, with our culture, arts, health and social care. So there's a really joined up piece of work there. So that links to the ALICE database. So you go in and you can find what services, what groups, and that you can refer to cultural activity as part of your health and wellbeing rather than waiting for other interventions.
So I'm going to move on to a kind of final area of interest, which is about place-based cultural policy. And I know Mark had some questions in this area.
Convener, it's been a really interesting session. I wanted actually to go back to the points made about community planning partnerships, and I'm interested in exploring their role and other forms of partnership in terms of, you know, strategically organising and delivering those place-based approaches. And I was struck by what Kirsty said earlier on, that there's perhaps a disparity around Scotland in the way that CPPs are incorporating culture and cultural organisations within their planning and articulating cultural outcomes. So I was interested in that. I was interested in what Billy was saying earlier on around how partnership working is perhaps spreading more now into health and social care partnerships, the value of social prescribing. And I was interested in Rebecca's point as well about how you have to kind of work sideways and then up in order to access the more strategic CPP. So I wonder if there's anything that you can kind of distill out of that in terms of your experiences, in terms of what works well with community planning partnerships. How does the cultural sector get its value and its voice into those objectives? And if there are any other parts of the architecture of local strategic planning that we need to consider beyond that, because it's a big picture. And I'm aware through what you've said this morning already that culture touches on so many different things, from community regeneration to social care to everything. So is our community planning partnerships a vehicle to do that, or are there other ways that we should be looking?
Happy to come in on that. I think, I mean, as I said earlier, obviously there's different approaches, and that's absolutely how community planning partnerships were set up, is that they are all slightly different. So there's, it's not about being uniform, but it's about how we get a cultural voice consistently across culture community planning partnerships. So there's been, we've had a lot of discussions with our members. Some of our members sit on community planning partnerships, you know, and are absolutely involved. And there we see that they're actually, you know, involved, and they can actually understand the discussions around the community, and there's opportunities for them to be involved, to look at, you know, whether it's a discussion around health and well-being, actually they can offer a service, and that connection is made, you know, much more fluidly rather than sitting outside and then trying to understand what's happened within the community planning partnership and be part of it. Other members are on, you know, some of the committees of community planning partnerships, the subcommittees, so again, you know, kind of involved at some level and able to kind of engage and be involved in shaping those conversations. And then there's areas where there's no engagement at all, and so it's very much, you know, trying to understand what's happening and then coming after the party to try and influence and kind of offer services and actually say there's potential partnership here. So, you know, from my perspective, it's not about, you know, our members being on community planning partnerships per se. It's about a voice for culture and a mechanism for a cultural voice, you know, and understanding that, you know, there needs to be some mechanism at a local level. So, you know, whether that's, you know, somebody from a library that's, you know, sits on as a statutory service, for example. I'm not saying this is what we would necessarily recommend. I'm just giving an example of, you know, there is a statutory service. Is there something there where people can feed in through a representative to have a cultural voice? So I think there is, for me, it's the voice of culture and having somebody that can give a representative opinion on behalf of the community. So not necessarily one organisation or one service, but actually it's that mechanism for people to feed in and then kind of take back as well from those opportunities. And similarly on health and social care partnerships, you know, again, we can see, you know, from our membership that where there's direct engagement, there's opportunities that are happening there, and there's some interesting, you know, approaches, and there's things that are being shaped and delivered. But again, where there's not that engagement, and it comes back to kind of Billy's point around this partnership and well-being, then again, it's much harder when decisions are made and then you're kind of trying to come in from the outside into those. So I guess kind of the key point is around understanding the role of CPPs across Scotland, understanding should there be a statutory need for a cultural voice through that, and then that might be determined locally depending on organisations and how culture is delivered locally. And I guess the kind of adding to that, which is a slight tangential point, but it's understanding, you know, what is culture. And we've kind of touched on that a little bit already, but I think culture for some people is almost a slight barrier in terms of the words. You know, what is culture? Is it highbrow? Is it theatre? Is it opera? Is it something that's, you know, for the public? You know, so there's something around perception of what we mean when we talk about culture as well. And I know that there's a bit of a move towards the term everyday creativity to capture at a local level a lot of the activities that are happening. And so again, it's just understanding where the barriers are and how that fits in terms of the voice.
That was very insightful, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to bring Kim in and then I'll come to the other members of the room. Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. I would certainly say agree with Kirsty's comments there, and certainly there are opportunities to improve the connection with our community planning partnership. Culture would definitely be embedded in all four of our local outcome improvement plan priorities. However, the clear detail and connect of the four priorities would certainly at this current time be connected to the economic development priority. And therefore, a lot of the focus and channeling will be around the economic development aspect, therefore maybe to the detriment of the overall well-being of our population and how culture can contribute to the well-being of our population. So I think there is, I'm glad to note that in Moray, you know, culture is connected to our community planning partnership and our LOIP, but there is certainly more explicit information and connections that could develop to sort of showcase the impact of culture on our overall community and not specifically just connected to the economic development of the area. Thank you.
Thank you. Rebecca, you wanted to come in. Billy, did you want to come in after Rebecca?
Yeah, sure. No, thank you for the question. I suppose I was going to say, I think at the moment, although I'm thinking this will probably change as we develop the cultural partnership, and one of the things we're looking at is how that partnership will work with other partnerships that there are in our region and not cause any duplication but dovetail. And so we are about to start talking to the community planning partnership about how we can do that. But I think at the moment, we're very much kind of in and around it, if you like. There's lots of things happening, and I'm just thinking a few examples. There is a creative wellbeing project for the region has developed from one of our creative organisations in Langham, from a sort of project they did through lockdown on creative art journals. They've been successful in getting funding from the NHS Endowment Fund, but also, and then also the creative wellbeing, sorry, the Community Wellbeing Fund, to run a two-year project which will set up a wellbeing network to make creative interventions into the clinical and the community-based sort of healthcare systems. And if you like, that's kind of working around, I guess it's grassroots, and ultimately will deliver on what the community planning partnership is trying to do. Then you have the Stove and their creative placemaking. They're on the place planning partnership not the community planning partnership, but the place planning partnership. So if you like, there's kind of an influence and a voice in and around there. And then I sit on the Community Learning and Development Partnership, and they were, when we were developing the cultural strategy, we had two reference groups, one from the cultural sector and another we wanted from the non-cultural sector. And in the event, the Community Learning and Development Partnership became our non-cultural sector kind of lead kind of reference group. So there's a good kind of connections in there, but as yet we're not in the Community Planning Partnership, but hopefully that will come. And it's just finding the right mechanism. And I guess, as you were saying, certainly within the way that things are set up, because I suppose the lead for cultural development is within the council, but in a different section and lower down, it doesn't feature in the Community Planning Partnership as it is at the moment, but hopefully that will change. Yeah.
Okay, Billy.
Yeah, thanks. A really good question. And there's a couple of things, I suppose, that we just have to recognise contextually. One, and Rebecca's just summarised it really effectively, it is a complicated landscape. Community Learning Development Partnerships, CPPs, Health and Social Care Partnerships, you know, various forums. So understanding that and understanding how you can make all of that complementary is in a sense, an ongoing challenge. So that's one contextual issue. The other contextual issue, I suppose, is that in terms of the public pound, there are always competing priorities, and culture always has to make its case. That's true at every level, including at community partnership level. So that's part of the context as well. I think it's a bit of a no-brainer for culture, frankly. So community planning partnerships, and I'm talking from a Glasgow perspective, obviously, principally, are a really important part of the landscape, really important in terms of presenting a real opportunity, I think, for culture to build coalitions, to build consensus, to really develop relationships and to move things forward. Certainly Glasgow Life are heavily engaged in the community planning partnership process and all of the networks, not just in terms of culture, in terms of our overall the work that we do, and I think that's really positive. I think we could probably do more, and I think the community planning partnerships possibly could be their understanding and the priority they attach to culture could be better from my point of view. But we're in there, and we're in there arguing the case for culture and building relationships, building networks and building coalitions around some of the things that I've spoken about already. So we take our ideas, we take our propositions to community planning partnerships, and you know, they are compelling, and we win over hearts and minds, and we move on from that. We build a platform for developing and implementing and executing these things. So I think for the cultural sector, I think it's really, really important that we do engage positively with that network. So that would be my response to that.
Okay. Katie?
I suppose from the Renfrewshire Council, we haven't had to make the case for culture as hard recently, because obviously we coalesced around that UK City of Culture bid and the legacy plan that came out. So we had already got a lot of buy-in to keep that investment on the table for the activity that we are taking forward until April 2024 due to the hiatus because of COVID. So really we are seeing that cultural regeneration as a really positive driver for economic and social change in Renfrewshire. And the CPP, along with many other organisations, are part of all of that discussion around how our investment is being spent. And it's a substantial investment, and it comes back to how we're going to tell our story through the impact of evaluation and evidencing how we have made that change. But I think we are certainly in a position where the case hasn't had to be really driven home as much. But that's not to say we're hitting challenging times. Things are changing all the time. Future Paisley concludes in April 2024, and that is why we're really committed to seeing if we can change policy to really embed some of these activities like the CAST, like the social prescribing, cultural social prescribing. But yet, all of these partner voices are really influential in how we're driving this whole programme.
OK. Okay. Mark, are you okay? Thank you. Maurice, did you have some questions?
Yeah, I was just wondering, in the context of place-based culture policy, how you measure success and what metrics are being used, and indeed if there's any standardisation so you can compare across either different sectors or indeed local authority areas. I don't know who would like to start on that. Katie.
I might jump in just because I spent the last year finalising an evaluation framework, which has been extremely complex. But when we talk about sharing best practice, I sort of think all of this that work that we are undertaking could be utilised not just within Renfrewshire Council, but we did a partnership, Renfrewshire Council, with the University of Western Scotland to create the Centre of Culture, Events and Sport. And that dialogue across the 80 live projects we're doing across every aspect from civic pride to health and social care. We have to see what our high level is, what our grassroots are doing, and find the sub-outputs and sub-outcomes across that. Because under each of our five step changes, we have three strategic outcomes against each of them. So we can directly go to our project leads. They can take their project and they can use the framework to find themselves within it. So everybody should find their position within that framework. Then you can use the sub-outputs and sub-outcomes to actually determine the data you're collecting, both qualitative and quantitative. And we have a process now where we get a report back every quarter. The information is put into a smart sheet. We can then identify exactly how we are hitting protected characteristics, how much external funding is coming in. We can actually pinpoint all of that. So when we look at the evaluation and look at the impact, we're starting to drive really strong data. We're sort of using the Scottish Household Survey, that's the right word. But what we have is this sort of tool of information. So everybody has a user-friendly framework, and we've given them the tools to then identify and say, you should look at this, because that will be able to capture some of the information that you're doing in your particular field. So we've got a sort of bundle of indicators that a lot of programmes can sit under, and then we've got a bit of bespoke. So actually, it's a really... We've just launched it in January, the first out of reporting is just coming in. People are already seeing how useful it is. It's not to say they weren't gathering data before, but we're trying to find a way to get a cumulative picture from all of these multiple projects that we're running, which has been highly complex, and that's why it's taken so long for us to get to the point. And obviously the impact will be found much further down the line once Future Paisley is finished, but we can already evidence the impact that's happening, and it's just about the longer term. So if we are doing something with Castlehead High School, new qualifications, are we really putting the stepping stone? Are they going to go into creative workforce? We all only know that 5-10 years. So, but if, at least if we've got the foundation that's really robust, I think we've got really great data and metrics that we can put against that.
Thanks. And just as a follow-up, Katie, are you able to compare your framework with a similar local authority like Dundee City Council, for example?
I think what has happened in the past, and forgive me because I've only been in the role for a year, I think there will have been a lot of work to do comparisons before that, because this has been years in the making. And so I would say they would have used evidence to start to see what they could use that would then be specific that we could shape into the Renfrewshire Council framework, I would have thought.
Okay, thanks. Rebecca?
I just thinking about how difficult it is to think of how you do that, because you're starting from so many different baselines in your different communities. My first reaction is kind of community response, is talking to that community how they felt an intervention has been. But I guess the other sort of thing is thinking down that kind of place planning more holistically. You know, there will be kind of like around a place. There is the place planning tool, isn't there, where people can assess how they feel on certain, it's like it becomes like a spider's web. And I guess kind of you really want to sort of see the kind of cultural sort of impact kind of embedded within that, so that you're seeing that the, just, you know, how that changes from the first time that you're looking at that place, and how that place feels about itself, and then how it feels about it afterwards. But I think it's difficult sometimes to to remove that cultural input from the other inputs that are going in a way it shouldn't be separate, should it? It should all be part of a one if we're taking a kind of holistic approach to a place and kind of responding to what that place feels it needs and giving it the means to kind of build on its assets and develops, then it should be kind of holistic. But I guess there's kind of like thinking of, because we are thinking about this, but aren't there yet. We're only just starting to build our cultural partnership and create an action plan for the cultural strategy and the metrics that would base on that. So we're just starting to think about it. But I think, that there's the household survey, but that is for us, that is like so few people in our and in our area. And actually, it's not necessarily kind of, we don't know what they've accessed to tell us what their, what their reactions are. So I think that it is something we need to put in place, but without overloading people. I was quite interested. I went with a colleague there's an evaluation session in Hull after their City of Culture, and it was about how they had made a difference. And it was interesting to sort of hear that there were sort of short-term measures, but as you say, there's longer-term measures. But they had been doing a kind of community survey for Hull citizens more generally about how they felt about their selves and where they lived and their role. And they had seen in the different annual surveys a change in that kind of positive feeling as a result of the City of Culture Festival. So I don't know if I'm sort of answering. I guess I'm throwing ideas in the air, but I'm thinking it's not necessarily, I think it's maybe more holistic than just the cultural elements.
Definitely. I mean, do you think there's a role for, thinking about community engagement, some sort of standardised questions so that actually it doesn't stop, whether it be individual sectors or councils adding to that, but at least there's some form of comparison so that, we can actually recognise where there's good practice and actually try and bring everyone up together.
No, I think absolutely, and I think there are sort of frameworks being used already. I guess, but I think it is pulling that together, and you're right, it would be good to be able to make comparisons with other areas, but I think we certainly have found that in the past, because each local authority's area has a completely different kind of cultural landscape, it can be really difficult because you're kind of comparing apples with pears, but it would be great to find some way of, a simple way as well, something that's not too difficult for your arts organisation on the ground or your community group to do, yeah.
Quite daunting to develop from scratch, and if everyone's doing that all at the same time, it seems like there's a use of resources that actually perhaps is a centralised role there in some shape or form.
You're absolutely right, and I'm just thinking about sort of a cultural organisation, say, who's getting its funding from various different sources, and if all those funders are actually asking for different metrics, it can be so difficult to. So much time kind of spent on that aspect of it when you should be just doing the stuff.
Yeah, no, that's really helpful.
So Billy wants to come in as well, and then I'll come to Kirsty. Can I just ask a very quick question of Katie? And obviously that was a big project you've been involved with, and you said considerable amount of time and complexity. What was the driver for putting it in place? Where did that come? What policy driver come from?
The driver is because the level of money, as we all know, all public money needs to be properly evidenced and evaluated. I think from my position in Future Paisley, this is the mechanism that will allow for future investment decisions being made. Because that is where a lot of the evidence is going to sit, saying you should continue to do this and you should continue to do that, because it's clear evidence. But the framework, picking up on Rebecca, I think where it sits, because we've got these five-step changes that work across all, it's about community and well-being or sustainable and resilient things. Actually, these frameworks, instead of have everybody working off separate ones, I do think are comprehensive piece, and I would be really happy to share it because it has been such a long term in the thing, and actually it could be useful for other local authorities to look at, because I think we have project leads dealing with it because of the thing. If we're giving it to individuals to do much smaller pieces, it's that thing of we need to consolidate it, because otherwise, as you say, you spend your time writing different reports for different organisations, and actually a framework should something that's really picking up on all of the objectives for so many of us, this cross-pollination between us all, actually could be really useful.
Thank you for that. So I'm going to bring in Billy and then Kirsty, and I don't know if Kim wants to come in at the end as well.
I think in some ways maybe what I was going to say has been covered now. I think what I was going to say echoes Rebecca's phrase. I think she captured it very elegantly in that we're not quite there yet. It's a really good question, and I don't think any of us have got the answer. Lots of different agencies ask very different questions. So if you're working with the Health and Social Care Partnership and they've provided money, they will ask specific questions that require a specific type of evaluation. The health service will ask slightly different questions, much more clinically focused, that requires a very different set of evaluations, and so on and so on. Different agencies use different software. We might use a software called Upshot. Someone else will use something else. So it is a very another complicated picture. Katie, I think, summarised it perfectly. I think there is space for a conversation about some kind, and this is happening across other parts. So if you think about the events sector, there's a similar conversation about how might it be possible to create some kind of national evaluation framework that would have to be very flexible and very modular, but I think there's a space for that conversation, and that might be something that falls out of this process. I think that could be really positive, and I think we would all probably be really keen to engage in that kind of process, because I think that is something that would really benefit the sector. It would require lots of agencies to engage in that, you know, out just not cultural organisations specifically, but out with the sector, like health and social care partnerships, like community planning partnerships, like the NHS, and like some of the national agencies. But if there was a willingness, if there was a coalition of the willing, I think that would be a really, really positive initiative for the sector nationally. Thanks.
Kirsty?
Thank you. We are actually doing quite a bit of work in this area, and by no means do we have any answers to this before I start, but one thing that we are looking at is a common approach around reporting against social value. So we've got we're using there's a platform that's used across England. It's started on the sport and leisure side, so it's the Moving Communities platform, which captures a range of data across all local authorities with public leisure in England. And it's been really providing some really, really good data. It's still got, you know, development to go, but we've been looking at it for our members in Scotland. We're actually working with Scottish Government analysts at the moment to understand their views on it, and actually whether they would see the information that would come as credible, whether it would kind of fit from a Scottish Government perspective. But we've got a few members that have signed up, because you can sign up to the platform individually, the Data Hub platform. We have some members in Scotland are already using it at a local level, and we've piloted pulling together that information from those that are already engaging, which is really powerful. I wish I had the stats to hand, but I don't have them off the top of my head. But it was across four trusts, and it was the social value of what they were providing. And there is a scope within that to break that down for cultural services as well, so that it can actually be focused around culture. And so I think there's potential. I don't think it's you know, going to solve all of the issues that we have. It's not, as Billy was talking about, an evaluation framework, but it's a start in terms of some consistent data reporting. So we've been working with COSLA as well, because if this was to go ahead, for us it would be much wider than our membership. You know, it would be across the whole country. And at some point in time, you know, as England are looking at the moment, they're looking to start capturing, you know, kind of local groups, activity, community groups, and feed that in so they get a place-based picture through the platform. That's in development, but that's the intention. So I think there's potential there to look at something as a starting point that's not onerous. It essentially captures participation data and some financial information. So it's not anything that our members wouldn't already be capturing, and there's an automatic feed into the platform. So I feel like I'm going to sound like a salesperson for this platform. But I think it's something that's in development that might have some legs to give us a starting point for some kind of national data.
Thanks. Kim, you wanted to come in as well.
Yeah, just to say that I concur completely with Rebecca and Billy's points in regards to the asks of the various asks of funders in regards to whatever project you're doing, and how these are very different and complex. So a standardisation would be great, but not sure how you achieve that. And And really, just from a selfish perspective, I think an area that we certainly need to improve on is that evidence of social value and economic value of culture to really strengthen the case in the Lucullit area. So happy to receive any information or systems that are being developed. And I think that's where it is. Sharing of best practice is key for us to really strengthen the cultural market out there. So, yeah, just Maria will happily receive any content. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm looking to my colleagues. Are there any final questions this morning? Any closing remarks? Can I just say again, thank you so much. It's been a really, really helpful session. The first in our inquiry in this area. So I've got a few more to do, a few more visits to do. And I think some of our colleagues will be visiting Dumfries and Galloway as part of that experience. So we're really looking forward to continuing with this work. But thank you for your attendance this morning. And having taken agenda item 2, the decision to have a consideration of evidence in private for this meeting and future meetings, I now move into private session.